argument. There's a narrative, there's a storyline as well, but that notion of good war and the response that liberal democracies had to aggressive authoritarian regimes, what is the response up to this point in time? Indifference. The United States does not want to defend itself, does not see itself as defending freedom around the globe. It doesn't join in the League of Nations, et cetera, et cetera. And I made the point is that in the second stage of World War II, the first is that phony war, the second stage of World War II, the Nazis are going to effectively wipe out liberal democracy on the continent. The only one remaining is Great Britain, and they have a change in government, and you have someone like Winston Churchill who's able to articulate, listen, we can't compromise on these things. You can't just say, well, some people get protected by the law and other people don't. Right? We're rounding up the Jews, but the other Germans are protected under the Constitution. But you can't say that and claim to be a representative of a constitutional state. And what I talked about was, in essence, Great Britain, because the United States is unwilling to support them, is going to, for a year, be fighting by themselves against the Axis powers. And they are going to demonstrate through this, in essence, the same thing we're seeing right now in Ukraine, and that is that the way in which to defeat an opposing country is going to be going after civilians. Again, keep that in mind when we're talking about a good war. We'll talk today about the Great Patriotic War. We're talking about a war that is going to kill civilians more than it's going to kill combatants, people in uniform, et cetera, et cetera. And in essence, what this does is to provide an opportunity, and by the way, this is a V1 rocket, not a V2. So there was this weird technology in that it wasn't an intercontinental ballistic missile kind of thing. It wasn't supersonic. And you could literally see them, and people would talk about it. You'd hear them, it sounded like a lawnmower engine going over. The trouble was when the lawnmower engine cut out, because that meant the thing was coming down. Referred to as blockbusters, right? So Hollywood turns it into big movies and, you know, whatever. We use these kind of war metaphors. But what this does is to signal to the United States, you're looking and seeing someone else fighting a fight against ideas that matter to them and should matter to you. And in essence, what the United States does is to see, in essence, a country that is unwilling to kowtow to this no matter the costs. And put it into context, right? The amount of people die in Britain during this is going to be the equivalent of a 9/11 every week. And they're going to say, bring it on, continue, right? But we need some help. Sound familiar? Yeah.
After a year of sitting back, what changes automatically that brings us into
this? I think it's a great question, because what changes is the mindset of the American public, right? We talked today about what's going on with Ukraine, and one of the biggest variables is social media, is being able to see people in the environment. The same thing is true here in England, and that is you have radio. Doesn't seem like it's as modern, but radio still is a fairly modern innovation. And radio brings directly into the homes of the American public these stories in English, right? So there isn't that cultural barrier that you're able to say, in essence, these people are fighting to live like this, right? To live in a democracy, to have constitutional protections, to have an economic system that rewards capital and all those kinds of things. So the biggest change that takes place is the American public is increasingly recognizing that this is a fight worth fighting. Why otherwise are the British going through this, right? And in essence, what you see is Churchill being able to articulate that, and we know what's going to be coming. I finished with it last time. You know, again, as a teacher of history, it's rare when these opportunities come together. But yesterday, right, so what do you see? You see Volodymyr Zelensky, the president of Ukraine, addressing the exact same British parliament. Now, he's not physically there, but he's doing the exact same thing that Churchill is doing, and needless to say, the way in which he is going to...
Try this 6-second method right, tonight to reverse time. Like,
it was a little bit of... Here's Zelensky.
For us now is to be or not to be. You all know this Shakespearean...
First, he's quoting... Shakespeare.
Question. For 13 days, this question could have been asked, but now I can give you a definitive answer. It's definitely yes to be. And I would like to remind you the words that the United Kingdom have already heard, which are important again. We will not give up and we will not lose. We will fight till the end, at sea, in the air. We will continue fighting for our land, whatever the cost.
Right. He is playing with, he is in essence returning to that same question. We shall go on in the end, we'll fight in France, we'll fight in the seas and oceans, we'll defend our island, right? He's pulling on that same tradition of World War II, of saying in essence, this is what you told the rest of the world when you were facing this same situation. And where I finished last time is that Roosevelt as a president is finding himself in a very difficult situation. The American public is increasingly sympathetic, but how do you get the United States to commit to supporting an ally like this? He, in essence, goes straight to the American public, and I won't discuss it, and gives the garden hose speech. Lend-lease is more than a garden hose, right? Again, it's a false comparison to say no-fly zone. No-fly zone is a very dangerous setup, and you don't just kind of snap your fingers and say, well, no-fly zone. You know, people get shot down, that kind of stuff. But it's that same kind of, he's making an argument saying, we're going to help a friend who we know will pay us back if there's anything that's damaged as a result of this. But we're doing it because it's an emergency. What he's also doing is committing the United States to supporting the Great Britain in this fight with munitions, with armaments, and not forcing them to, in essence, pay cash on the barrelhead. It's at this point in time as well, what I didn't talk about last time was the second one. As I mentioned, this is an important slide. Remember this slide, right? You gotta get back to it. Little mention in your notes, right, is that not only do you have Lend-Lease, which we'll come back to, is going to, in essence, begin to jumpstart the American economy, but you also have the meeting of Franklin Roosevelt and Winston Churchill in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean. They meet at sea, right, because they're not, they don't want the American president to be going to Great Britain during a war. And be taking sides, so they're in international waters. And what they do, and their staff does, is to lay out, what is this war about? Is it about territory? Is it about, grievances? Is it about this SOB, that SOB? They're going to establish what's going to be referred to as the Atlantic Charter. We are not at war. In August of 1941, we're not part of World War II, right? But what we've agreed to is that this is what the war is about. It's about ideology. And again, in a classic fashion, Roosevelt was very good at being able to boil down complex issues that are very clearly accessible to the average American. They are about freedoms, the four freedoms. Freedom of speech, freedom of religion, and in large part, speech is in this case, media. The ability to report injustices against someone else or the nature of the world around you, right? Even if you don't like it. Notice Putin calling the critics fake news. I wonder where he got that idea from. Freedom of religion, particularly Judaism, right? In this case, but again, a core value of the United States. Freedom from fear, and in essence, this is an argument that says small countries, because they're small, should not simply be allowed to get gobbled up by others, right? If they're small economically or small geographically, that they should have ideological values. And the big one down here is freedom from want. And that one, as you can imagine, is kind of difficult. He's not talking about welfare for everybody. What he's talking about here is that an economic system based on capitalism, supply and demand, industrial capitalism, finally finance capitalism, when we get to the 20th century, later in the 20th century, is that capitalism requires that you don't have protective borders, you don't put up tariffs, you don't have this way in which we're going to have whole sections of the world, in this case Nazi Germany or the Soviet Union, saying in essence you cannot trade here. And this is big for the British, because the British have colonies, right? Why do they have India? Why do they have Singapore? Why do they have? Because they have control over that trade. And in essence, what the Brits are going to be forced to do is to say, we no longer are supporting this idea of colonization. Okay? This is a major statement in terms of why this war is going to be fought by the United States. And it's done before the war. It's not done afterwards, it's not like Vietnam, where all of a sudden the American public says, why is my kid over in Vietnam? Oh, we're making the world safer tomorrow, that kind of thing. Okay? Right? So Roosevelt is setting all this up before him. He is very clearly focused on the European theater. That's going to come into play as we kind of go forward. Right? The U.S. in the Pacific and Japan is a conflict that is largely won over access to the mainland marketplace. China, obviously, is important. Korea, Indochina, which is effectively Vietnam today. China, as I kind of mentioned briefly when I was talking about the 1900-1930 period of time, has gone into a period of civil war and foreign occupation. And the United States is less concerned about the long-term access to China than they are to the way in which Japan is cutting China off from American materials. By the time we get to the 1930s, and you can see these sort of horrific attacks on Chinese civilians, what you're seeing here is, in essence, a willingness on the part of the Japanese to destroy the infrastructure of China so they will be in order to take action with it. By 1937, and invading of Manchuria, what you see is, in essence, an open willingness by Japan to colonize the mainland of the Pacific Coast. And Roosevelt has options here, just like he did with Nazi Germany. Nazi Germany takes Poland, Nazi Germany takes Czechoslovakia. What could we do? Well, what we could do with Germany is to say, if you keep doing this, we will declare war. We don't do that. We don't have issue ultimatums. In essence, we turn and say, well, we'll help England, we'll help their opponents. By contrast, the United States sees Japan through the lens of sort of a global racism. Now, somewhere in here, you know, Japanese are equally racist. I mean, human beings are human beings. And so the more you study your local environments, you're gonna realize, if you look at the Pacific Rim, the Japanese, the Koreans, the Chinese, the Taiwanese, you know, they all see themselves as very different kinds of people. But one of the assumptions is that there's no way in hell Japan is going to be willing to take on the United States. And so what Roosevelt does is, in essence, threaten them with embargoes. Japan gets almost all of their iron and fuel from the United States. And Roosevelt says, you either get out of China or we cut you off, right? And this ultimatum is going to force the Japanese to kind of come up with a response. What they come up with, again, you can feel it, like a fish in a pond from which the water was being gradually drained. The argument was, in essence, here's Japan, and this is a subset of a map we're going to come back to in just a second. Here's where the oil and natural resources are largely concentrated. This is Indonesia, has a lot of oil reserves. Again, here's Vietnam, French Indochina at the time, a lot of natural resources, tungsten, steel, coal, rubber plants, et cetera, et cetera. The Americans are right here in the Philippines, right? So we have occupied the Philippines since the 1898 Spanish-American War. The idea that the Japanese come up with, and it's called the Southern Operation, is to suddenly and as strongly as possible punch down into the southern region. So the reason why it's called Southern Operation is they're going straight south, right? And their argument is that we know we can't beat the United States in a stand-up fight. But what we can do is surprise them enough and take control over these territories, dig in, and make it so difficult for the Americans to get us out, right? Notice that there's no European help here. We're not gonna have Russians here, we're not gonna have, Germany, it's the United States. One of the things we talk about World War II, this is the war that we are going to be the most involved in. This is the theater that we're going to be most influential on. But if you'll notice, where's Pearl Harbor? Hell, where's Midway? Right? You can't even see it on this map, and that's instrumental. This dotted line right here is going to be really important in just a second. Right? In essence, what you see is that Japan recognizes that they are at they don't have options. They don't have a way in which to find their way through this. And they see this as the only possible solution. Again, history is 2020, you can look back. There was an opportunity to negotiate. There was an opportunity to avoid this conflict. But the focus is on Europe. The focus is on Hitler. The focus is on what's going on in World War in the European theater. And Roosevelt is not a Pacific Sino, he just doesn't have an interest in that area, right? So there's a lot of bias that's going on in regards to how this thing's set up. Pearl Harbor which is going to obviously be attacked as a result of this southern operation, is extremely target-rich. So this is a picture actually from a Japanese torpedo bomber on December 7th. You can, this is on that real time, but you can see it. You can see how many are, these are all battleships right here. These are all support class cruisers and what have you. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 major American battleships. Now the battleships in World War II were considered at the start of the war to be the greatest asset, military asset in the Pacific Fleet. All of ours are sitting next to each other in the middle of this deep water harbor in Pearl Harbor. Right here is the Arizona. I'm not sure if that's the strike. I don't think it is, but we're gonna see an example of that. But it is the perfect target-rich opportunity. The problem is, it's so far away, I didn't even see it on the map, and I'll come back to scale in just a second. No one assumed that the Japanese were gonna be able to launch a coordinated attack. And even as late as November of that year, the US is still requesting or demanding the Japanese removed. There still isn't an argument that says, listen, let's meet at a negotiating table and figure this thing out. The Japanese themselves are operating under a cultural tradition which has a sense of honor of saying you never attack someone. There's a famous story of a samurai who his entire life is trying to find this one guy. And he finally finds him and he is asleep. And he walks away because he's not gonna just kill somebody in their sleep, and his own honor wouldn't prevent that. They told their diplomats to break off diplomatic relations with the United States at 1 o'clock. Their problem is that they sent, classic administrator, they sent a huge, you know, telegram for them to decode, first of all, then translate from Japanese to English, then make an appointment to meet the American ambassador. The United States is not informed of a broken diplomatic relations until after the attack has begun. So, yeah, I mean, it is a sneak attack. It is not one that is preordained. Recognize that for a month now, American commanders are going to be on high alert. And December 8th, so this is December 7th, on December 8th, the Japanese are gonna attack the Philippines, our naval station in the Philippines. Where are our planes? They're wingtip to wingtip. A day later, we're still gonna get caught with our pants down, in large part because of the way in which we assume the military action. The attack is coordinated by Yamamoto, arguably one of the most brilliant naval aces. He's thought that way in terms of American people who are going to study this. Naval War College has an entire class on Yamamoto. His command ship is the Akagi. It's this one right here. I always like to point out, if you remember when I was talking about how the Japanese were told they couldn't build any battleships, the Akagi's frame was a battleship frame, but as you can see, what did they do? Because they were told, no, you can't have battleships. Let's put a flat surface on here and turn it into something called an aircraft carrier. The Japanese are gonna be well in advance of this, right? There are plans for three major sorties. They're planned for three major attack waves. The first two go out, 6 a.m., 7 a.m. Yamamoto decides not to launch the third because he looks and says, I have completely surprised the United States. These are always difficult images to see. When you see this guy's hand, right, that's the Arizona right there. You're gonna see it later on again. That's 1,100 American servicemen dying, right? Right there, at that image, that right there, that's the Arizona. The damage is unprecedented, right? And the fact that he doesn't launch a third wave is one of the more critical mistakes, if you want to call it that, on an absolute devastating military attack. Over 300 airplanes are damaged or destroyed. By the way, this one's listed as damaged, right? No tail section, yeah, good luck flying that letter, right? All eight of the battleships, our most important military assets, supposedly they aren't, right, are gonna be damaged or destroyed. All of the major support ships that are in Pearl, damaged or destroyed. As I mentioned, the Arizona, if you go to Honolulu or Pearl Harbor, it is still there. They decided to turn it into a war memorial, a war museum, right? If you've seen the movie Pearl Harbor, first of all, my apologies. It's only a few I've ever walked out of. But the recreation of the attack is really good. And it focuses on the reason why this takes place. In essence, it was a bomb drop that goes right down the ventilation shaft to the magazine where all the explosives are. So one thing you can say is that at least they died quickly. I mean, it was not a, not some. It was a devastating attack on one ship as a result. The difference is that the American aircraft carriers, none of them, not by luck, not by design, by luck, none of our four aircraft carrier groups were in Pearl Harbor at the time. One, the Enterprise was steaming towards it, but was not close enough to kind of intervene. And that third wave that Yamamoto does not take is critical because the third wave would have gone after all of our fueling and repair stations. Hawaii is no different than Japan. They don't have natural resources. And I mean, they got pineapples and stuff, right? I mean, but they don't have oil, they don't have coal, they don't have steel. All of that, every drop of aviation fluid, every can of axle grease or whatever, has got to be shipped in. They don't go after and destroy those resources. And they realize that the United States is very effective at being able to utilize those resources. We're going to get back to this in just a second. What this does, and you've got the United States hearing all this stuff going on in England, is galvanize the American public, right? So this clip here, and we'll come back to it more. Again, here's Roosevelt. This is the Declaration of War. He's in the House of Congress, in the House of Representatives. There's the Fasci standing right behind him up there, which I talked about. Going to give the following.
December 7th, 1941. A date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan. No matter how long it may take us to overcome this premeditated invasion, the American people in their righteous might will win through to absolute victory.
Yeah, a little bit of advice to anyone who wants to attack this country, and that is you never want to hear the president be able to refer to America in its righteous might, right? When this country unifies, when this country feels aggrieved, you do not want to be on the other end of that anger, right? And that's exactly what Churchill is talking about here. There was no event, there was no bombing in England, there was no invasion of a European country that was going to galvanize the American public like this attack in Pearl Harbor. The irony is that it's an attack that draws the United States to the Pacific theater, not to England. How can we even concern ourselves with Hitler? Hitler didn't attack us. Anybody know the answer to that? Hitler declares war on us. Smart guy, Hitler, right? His thinking was that Japan had never been beaten in a war, so they're not going to lose this one. It's the only reason why the American public is going to look to Europe in one way, shape, or form. We'll come back to that. There was a question about whether or not Roosevelt knew of this attack. There was obviously the tension that existed there. As I mentioned, we were already on full military alert 2 weeks before the attack occurs. Roosevelt's clear interest is on the European theater. He is not interested in a Pacific theater fight. He does not extend the kind of negotiating diplomacy that probably could have averted this scenario, or may have, who knows, again, historical 2020. It's only Hitler's idiocy in declaring war. Hitler himself drags the, because why? Because the United States is this mongrel nation of jazz music and hip hop and, you know, all these kind of strange things that are modern, and that's not going to get you anything. The question was, really the shock was, how could Japan do something like this? And again, there's libraries full of World War II stuff. One of the books that's probably the most effective in terms of comprehensive coverage is Paul Kennedy's book, Systemic, Pervasive, and Cumulative. It was baked into the cake. We just looked at Japan and said, this little country can't do anything against us. Right? Again, sound familiar? Sound like 9/11? They can't touch us. They can't do something like that. It doesn't make that attack anything worth celebrating, but it does expose the kind of ways in which assumptions can lead you into these kinds of scenarios. What Pearl Harbor does, and by extension, the galvanizing effect we were talking about, is end American isolation. So this is the second half. Everybody knows Day of Infamy speech, right? Or at least a reference to it. Infamy is a bad thing, by the way. A student one time said, oh, we're getting married, it'll be a day of infamy. No, we're going to be a day of fame, whatever. Infamy is not a good thing. But he starts out by talking about that in his declaration. But later on, he is going to go on and say, what does this mean? A again, he is not doing this subtly or quietly or, oh, by the way, we're also going to do this. He has clearly stated that this war is going to change the way in which America addresses the rest of the world. This is about ideas. This is about what we stand for. This is about our economy. This is about getting jobs, right, and being able to do the rest of that stuff. And notice the tone. Again, Roosevelt has that optimism. He swings his head around. I like a little toady. You know, you'll see this guy come up with a glass of water, right, you know, standing. Again, wait a minute. I thought he couldn't use his legs. But notice how he is going to re-reference those four freedoms. What is it that Americans believe in? Freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom from fear, freedom from want. He's going to bring those in. He's talking to the American people by reminding them of the broader stakes of World War II.
Our own objectives are clear. The objective of smashing the militarism imposed by warlords upon their enslaved people. The objective of liberating the subjugated nations. The objective of establishing and securing freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom from want, and freedom from fear everywhere in the world. We shall not stop short of these objectives, nor shall we be satisfied merely to gain them and then call it a day. I know that I speak for the American people, and I have good reason to believe that I speak also for all the other people who fight with us when I say that this time we are determined not only to win the war, but also to maintain the security of the peace that will come.
Style is just unique when you kind of study this guy after a while. I mean, just his ability to sort of say, you know, we're going to just figure this out. We're going to make sure, we're going to rely on the American public to maintain the peace and the security that results. We don't do that in World War I. And in essence, we're gifted World War II as a result of that. The arguments that they're making in alliance with Great Britain is that if you are a liberal democracy, if you have values of personal freedoms and constitutional rights, you got to defend it. You can't just allow other people who are the same like that to get picked off one by one, because eventually you're left alone. He's writing a blank check. He's saying, you know, to the American fighting force, okay, go out there and make it good. We do not have the military yet to be able to do that. We do not have the capability in 1941 to be able to do that. Pretty good Navy, but in terms of land forces, not so much. The second big slide, so there's the first one I talked about, right, was the fire hose speech and the four freedoms. Here's the other one. What am I saying? I said, I'm going to ask you guys about this good war question. Here are two slides that you can use specifically to make that distinction. Those Wilsonian ideals I talked about, right, Wilson, this progressive, you know, we're going to have, you know, open treaties and no tariffs and no protectionism. Certainly no colonies, et cetera, et cetera. We are now going to enforce this. How are we going to do it? The United States is going to take the lead. We're not going to be an isolationist country. We can't be an isolationist country. Because twice now, when we've isolated ourselves, we've had global wars as a result. And another one is brewing today, right? You're looking and saying, okay, you are part of NATO. NATO ain't going to be strong enough to be able to resist a country like, I keep wanting to say Soviet Union, like Russia. During World War II, or as a result of it, what do you see? Very much like Reconstruction, during the war, you see the change that's taking place. The Atlantic Charter, we talked about, the Four Freedoms, we talked about. Later in the war, the Bretton Woods Agreement is probably the single most important. Bretton Woods Agreement says the United States, and by extension, you and me, taxpayer dollars, not a lot of taxpayer dollars, but still taxpayer dollars nonetheless, are going to fund the rest of the world's ability to be like us. Okay? We want the world to look like us, certainly economically, ideally, politically, but we're not going to get involved in that, right? So if you're going to be, we're not going to get involved in your domestic politics. But we want you to be like us economically, because when we're allied together that way, we're not going to fight each other. Democracies don't tend to start wars with each other. The International Monetary Fund, the World Bank, the General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade, the U.S. creates these. And again, I would be remiss in my role as a university historian to say that the last administration tried to get out of all of these, trying to say this isn't our responsibility, right? I don't think that was something that was discussed in the election. And the question has to be, why the hell were we trying to dismantle the very things that we had learned through World War II to create? The United States pays for this stuff. Not by ourselves, right? Other countries are part of this as well. Meaning what? Meaning we get to say how people behave in regards to trade, how people behave in regards to banking, how people behave in regards to finances, right? There's an old phrase, the person who pays the piper names the tune. The United States is paying the piper. The United States is the one who's in control of it and created as a result of World War II, right? So again, don't have to look at a good war that kills 50 million human beings and say, oh, that was good. We're glad for it, right? The reason it's called a good war, the reason it's arguably been called, is because of the role that the United States takes globally to defend the things that we are supposed to represent to ourselves, right? And we look around and say, it's just not right what's going on in Ukraine, and we're going to do what we can without sending troops, but we're going to do what we can to try and prevent that. That's all a product of World War II. Zelensky understands that, right? He's talking to the British Parliament, basically, doing a hip hop verse. He's sampling from Winston Churchill. All right. In looking at the two kind of stages, the Pacific Theater and the Atlantic Theater, is to recognize the responsibilities of the two of the allies in the United States as a result of this. I can't stress this enough. The Pacific Theater is effectively the United States by itself. And one of the things we are going to be successful in doing is conquering the space and time of the Pacific Ocean. Right? Do yourself a favor somewhere there. Just look at a globe. Look how big that is. And we'll come back to that map in just a second. This first stage in Yamamoto, there's another picture of Yamamoto down here, kind of specs this out almost perfectly. Right? He recognizes that Japan cannot stand up fight with the United States. And he, in essence, spells out, he believed that for the first 6 months, the Japanese would be able to do whatever they wanted to, because they're going to inflict such a hit on the American military. And obviously, the British and the French and the others are already long gone. He's going to put such a shock into the American military system that they're going to be able to do whatever they want. His argument then is, we have about 6 months after that. So if they struck in December 7th, they have until about June to begin negotiations for a separate peace. Meaning that, okay, America, we just took Sumatra. You don't even know where that is on a map. Just we'll keep that, but we'll get out of the Philippines and we'll leave you again. That there'll be a negotiated settlement. And he says, if we don't do that, so 6 months of running wild, 6 months to negotiate, if we don't have some sort of settlement within a year of our attack, we're going to be ground to dust, right? What he didn't understand was they're going to be ground to radioactive dust, right? But his timing is almost perfect. This first 6 months, what you see is the Japanese, their military is untouched and are going to effectively drive down into this southern region in which they're talking about. Here's a broader view of that map that I was talking about. Again, here's Pearl. Texas is always the best way. Texas is about the size of this main island in the Philippines. Texas is a big ass state, right? Drive across and go to Big Bend some point in time. It's a drop in a bucket compared to the sizes we are talking about here, right? And the United States is going to be by itself in responding to that. Look at these dates here, right? May, by February, right? They have pushed down straight south into these regions that contain all of those important resources. Island after island after island after island. To get them out, you have to go and dig them out each individually in some of the islands. They were finding soldiers still stationed there, Japanese soldiers, in the 1960s, 20 years after the war. Tough son of a bitches, right? You think about it. Still fighting World War II. Oh, it's over, didn't you know? Right? This co-prosperity sphere, which is what they call it, is going to reach its widest margin about when? May, 6 months after Pearl Harbor. And it's in May of 1942 where the United States, these little blue sparks start showing up, right? And the extent of this Japanese expansion is about 6 months. Battle of Coral Sea, so this is the region right here is called Coral Sea. is going to put, the Americans are going to lose the aircraft carrier Lexington. They're going to scuttle it, they're going to sink it themselves. And the Grey Ghost, the one that's right down when you drive down side, that one was commissioned and saw service in World War II. So it is, it's chopped, right? I mean, again, I mean, the legacy, it's a new boat, but it uses that. So the Lex that we have out there in the harbor does see active duty in World War II, much more active duty in Korea and in Vietnam, but nonetheless. But you can see, this is the extent of Japanese expansion. The Battle Corps Sea is unique in that they never faced each other, the Japanese and the Americans. It was done through submarines and aircraft carriers, et cetera, right? And so it was a different kind of warfare. You needed materials. You needed the trained men to be able to operate these things and to maintain them on something like an aircraft carrier. A couple of things to point out just in terms of where we are and what's going on. So first of all, there's Pearl Harbor. And this is Yamamoto to three battle groups. So he's talking about over 150 ships. Okay? 150 ships are going to go not once, but once and a half the length of the United States and not be seen. It's stunning, right? Of how that was. These are not guys with box cutters and, you know, whatever. This is a major industrialized military power being able to do that. Here's Midway Island, again, an American possession following the Spanish-American War, which I'll make reference to in just a second. Later on, when we get to what the American strategy is, we get closer, is going to be called island hopping. They want to get closer and closer and closer. This is Iwo Jima, right here. This is Okinawa. Both of those are going to be important locations. Why are they important? Well, you can hit the mainland of Japan with bombs. Again, there are no missiles yet, right? You can hit them with bombers. But bombers are very vulnerable. They got a lot of bombs, right? And they move relatively slowly, pretty high in the air. What do you have to have? You have to have fighters to support them. By the time you get close enough here, you now have close support for those bombers. Okay? We're going to do something, as we'll talk about in a second, in Midway Island, which is sort of a suicide mission, but you've got to get close. So the idea of the United States was to hop these islands to get closer and closer so that we can industrially overwhelm them with the materials that we're going to begin to drop on the nation of Japan. And we'll come back, obviously, come back to the second stage is after that 6 months. And you see a couple of instances, as I mentioned, the goal of the United States is to bring the war home to the Japanese, to make them suffer as a result of conducting this war, because they hadn't yet. They had no sense of it, obviously no free press to tell them of it. The Doolittle raid, Commander Doolittle is going to fly B-29 bombers off an aircraft carrier, but he's going to leave Midway Island and is going to reach the mainland of Japan and drop their payload on Japan. They're going to ditch their planes in China, and some of the pilots found sympathetic Chinese, some of them found Japanese occupiers, right? So it was sort of a one-way trip for these guys. But it's a moral boost, but it also takes place about the same time as when you're starting to see this kind of switch. As I mentioned, the Battle of Coral Sea, 6 months after Pearl Harbor. And it's here where the heroes of the war, multiple heroes, right? But one of the most important is the ability to break the Japanese battle codes, the ability to find out where their fleets are headed. A great untold story is this guy, Joseph Rookford. Now again, I don't know if you have Navy people, my family's mostly Navy and Army, you know, the sort of the meat potato services. And Navy people are particularly fastidious, right? You know, I mean, everything's clean, everything's pressed, you know, all that kind of stuff. I had one uncle one time, he passed away, but he served in World War II as Navy guy. I never saw his hair out of place, never once, right? No, he was just like, it was just always that, right? Rookford was not that kind of guy. Rookford wore a smoking jacket. He was a genius, he was a numerical genius, and he was a codebreaker. So he shows up in these meetings with all these Navy guys, you know, and he's wearing this kind of paisley smoking jacket. He goes, you know, we can break this code. We can figure out what the Japanese are going to do. And what they figure out is the Japanese are going to want to get close again to Pearl Harbor, and Midway Island stands in their way, right? One of the critical battles, there have been two movies about this, both of them suck, right? So sorry. John Ford, an American filmmaker, was on Midway Island when it took place, so John Ford actually captures a lot of video there. The Americans knew that Midway Island was going to be targeted. They re-outfit and resupply three aircraft carrier groups, right? One of them, regardless, Yorktown, is refitted in 24 hours. You never do that. You know, an entire aircraft carrier, meaning refueled, fixed, you know, all the food brought on board in one day. You know, no one is able to do that. The Americans were able to do that during the Second World War. It's going to be engaged in this. The problem was, again, size. How do you know where the battle groups are? And the weather was uncooperative. It was cloudy. It was, you know, kind of cast over. They're sending out these P-51 Dauntless bombers looking for them. Two of these groups, one by Wade McCluskey, one by Maxwell Leslie, are going to be so far out that it is unlikely that they're going to be making it back to their aircraft carriers. They don't know where the Japanese are. And just like a Hollywood movie, right? They're told to return. Maxwell says, no, I'm not going to do it. I want to make sure I find these guys. The clouds literally part, and 10,000 feet below these guys is what? Three Japanese aircraft carriers. And they're loaded with munitions. So the Japanese knew the Americans were in the vicinity, but they're bombing Midway with bombs that are supposed to go into concrete and blow up airstrips. Suddenly, you've got to refit those to say, we've got ships around here. We've got to put torpedoes on our planes. So there's ordnance all over the surfaces of these bombs, of these ships. Down come these P-51s, boom, 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 three aircraft carrier are destroyed. One's going to be scuttled by the Japanese. Out of the five that are sent there in terms of their battle, the numbers are staggering in terms of what happens afterwards, right? The Japanese enter with six aircraft carriers. They leave with two that are serviceable. The Americans leave with three aircraft carriers. They leave with all of them, right? In the next 3 years of the war, this gives you an indication of what Yamamoto was talking about. The Japanese are able to put on the sea six more aircraft carriers, right? In whatever it is, 3.5, 4 years, six more aircraft carriers. Big, huge, you see them. I mean, the Lex is a big, big boat. The United States puts in, anyone want to guess? 17, right, in 3 years. That's what Yamamoto was talking about, right? Waking a sleeping giant. They have no idea in their richest might what kind of production capacity is available. So the Battle of Midway is a turning point in terms of putting the Japanese on defensive. What the United States now is doing is getting closer and closer. The question is, what do we do when we get there? How are we going to invade the mainland of Japan, which had never been invaded before? What's the end look like in regards to this war? So, Guadalcanal, as I talked about. So this stage of World War I or World War II, keep in mind the Pacific Theater is a 100% American and its regional allies. So New Zealand and Australia and Canada, they're obviously participating as well. But the heavyweight responsibility is going to be on the United States. I say that because most people when they think of World War II, they think of the United States in Europe. And that's not as much of our role. What about Europe? European stage one. Obviously, the United States has been declared war and by Nazi Germany and by the Italians. We're in this war now. There really is no negative effects from this. And it seems weird to say that. Our entry into the war didn't harm the process. But as I mentioned, in 1940, our military is minute. We do not have we haven't spent money on a large military. As Americans, we don't care about the rest of the world. Arguably, what do you use a military for? It ain't to fight each other, it's to fight overseas. And we have no commitment to overseas, and as a result, we don't spend money on that. Our own population is unwilling to sort of, once this war breaks out, unwilling to make the changes that are required, right? I mean, again, stop me if you heard this one before, but I'm not, my freedoms are at stake. One of the problems is that Nazis, the Germans, he had these wolf packs with the ability to use submarine warfare. They were in the Gulf. They were up and down the eastern seaboard. And the American population was told, you know, we have servicemen who are going from this country to across the sea, and their ships are getting sunk. Could you turn your lights off at night? Because it's going to silhouette all of our ships, and it's going to make it real easy for people to see when ships are going. Right? Now I can't do that, right? Don't take away my freedoms. I'll drive away. And I'll make light of it, but it's this notion of the United States not being prepared for the kind of sacrifices that were necessary to be able to do this. The American strategy, military strategy, is going to be overwhelm someone else, right? bring, you know, when we get to the first Gulf War, not the 21st century one, but the first one, 1990, Colin Powell was in charge, and they said, "What's your strategy?" And he kind of looked at, you know, one of these press conferences, strategy. The Iraq Army at the time is the fourth largest standing army on the planet. What's your strategy to take on the Iraq Army? We're going to cut it off and kill it. Any questions? Right? You know, I mean, it was like our military strategy that is most effective for the United States is Ulysses S. Grant. Overwhelmed, right? We will outproduce you. We have a lot of people and we have a lot of munitions, and what we are going to do is to pick our battles so that we're going to hit you like a sledgehammer. We're not going to do little drips and drabs. We're not going to send in 2,000 here, 2,000 there if we go to war, right? They want to have the opportunity, the Americans want to have the opportunity to do that. The British, who are already there, are saying, whoa, 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 let's not get too ahead of ourselves. Again, the Brits have reason for that. World War I, they tried it a couple of times. They tried amphibious assaults, and they were disastrous politically and elsewhere. Right? So the Brits are looking and saying, listen, if we misjudge this, we're going to lose our country. You guys are going to, you know, be able to be around some more. The Soviets are going to look and say, listen, one thing that's going to stop the Nazis is going to be a second front. That's the thing that the Germans fear the most, is fighting on two sides of their country. And the big question, where the hell did the Soviets come from, right? In June of 1941, again, thank you for having Adolf Hitler at this point in time, Hitler's racial ideology is that the Slavic people who make up particularly southern western region of the Soviet Union are secondary, you know, human strain, right? He's a racist. He's looking and saying they're not capable of sustaining any defense. He is in contact, Hitler is in contact with the then king of Iran, and the king of Iran has all this oil, and the Nazis need oil. And so in essence, Hitler commits effectively 60 to 70% of his entire fighting force to slice into the Soviet Union. The idea, again, we'll get to a map in a second. The idea is to get to those oil fields in Iran, to get to access to petrochemicals, because that's going to be the kind of a key here. The Soviet Union was obviously harmed by their own leader, right? Is that Stalin himself has been purging the military. But the preparations for this were, he was caught off guard in kind of a classic sense. Russia's already devastated, but you're looking at 5 million troops in the first 6 months, 2 million civilians killed or wounded in the first 6 months. The Americans do not have the capacity to open a second front. What we do is Operation Torch. Our allies, the Soviet Union, they're like, open a second front, take some pressure off. Make the Germans respond. Our response is to invade North Africa. And we're not very effective in doing that either, right? It's that by and large, we're just too green and we don't know kind of what's going on in regards to the world, right? Where this changes, and I'll stop here. Stalingrad is going to be, again, in the news. This is Ukraine right here, right? This right here, see Stalingrad on the Volga, is the turning point of the European war and stopping the wars. So I'll pick this up again on Friday.